Hello friends, this is Dr. Praveen Parmar from Vyapaar Jagat, and today we have Mr. Rohan Shah with us. He is a design thinking and innovation consultant. He is also a CEO of the company Headwig. In today's time, you know, there are so many large corporates, they are moving towards the design thinking implementation. So design thinking is a new methodology, it's a new tool for the large corporates and for the organizations which has complex their business processes. So to simplify the business processes, design thinking is a tool, is a method which can solve the problems. So today let us know more about what design thinking is and how Mr. Rohan Shah has started his career in the design thinking. So let us start with the design thinking. And before we'll have the introduction of Mr. Rohan Shah, and he will talk about the entire journey so far he has with the design thinking and his early days. So Mr. Rohan Shah, please welcome to our show and
thank
please
you.
Start with your introduction. Yeah.
Thank you. So hi Praveen. Thank you for inviting me. And so I have started design thinking since almost last 10 years ago in 2008. So my early days, if I want to talk a little bit about early days. So I started my career with, I went to US, I studied there. I did my engineering in product design engineering, and then I joined SAP, field of SAP as a consultant and as a solution architecture in year 2008.
Yeah, so Rohan, tell us something about your early days and about your first job and how did you start your career?
So it's a story by itself. So I did my graduation in product design in year 2000. I graduated in 2007 December. And 7 December. So and since 2008, as soon as I finished my graduation in product design from University of Southern California, and I started looking for a job. It was 2008. So you know that time was the financial crash happened. It was extremely difficult for a foreign graduate or an immigrant to get a job. So I was facing quite a lot of challenges during those days to just find a job. And at that time I had a thought about, I was not too clear with my vision. You know, I was just going with a conventional rut of finishing my master's from the college, get a good job. And that was the original thought process. You know, nothing unusual, just one more student, one more immigrant in the United States. That's how I was. And so 2008 I started, so as soon as I graduated, I started applying for a job. But due to the time of 2008 financial crash I was talking about, the job was very difficult. I was almost, if I want to say that, I was almost applying more than 15-20 jobs a day. And almost seven, eight months, I didn't even get a single response or a single interview. I didn't.
Yeah, really say something.
That was a tough time. That was a tough time. I was living at my uncle's place. I was living at my friend's couch, and because I didn't have money to pay rent, so I was just, you know, stopping by at a different friend's place for a few months. My uncle's place for a few months. With my uncle and my grandparents. So family and friends were there. So, you know, things have passed by, but yeah, it was a difficult time because I was applying for almost 15-20 jobs a day, but not a single interview. And I remember with the dates, it was end of August, I think 25th of August, I was sitting at night and applying for a job. At my uncle's place, I came across one profile, one online profile called company called Car, it was an SAP consultant job, and I did an SAP at my college. So I applied as a fresher, and then, as normal, I did my application. I slept, and I woke up early in the morning. I was having a cup of coffee with my uncle, and I was discussing the same thing that, you know, it's been 9-8 months and I'm not getting a call any, and I don't know how I'm gonna do it. And so in US, you know, when you go on a student visa, after you complete your school, that is you're on F1. So that after that you get a 1 year of a period where you can find a job.
Okay.
That period is called CPD.
Okay.
So within the CPD period, it says that in order to apply for an H1B, you need to have at least 3 months of a job. Now I'm already graduated in December 2007.
Yeah.
I'm talking about August 25th, 2008. So almost 8 months
eight
have
months
finished.
Yeah.
I only have 4 more months.
Okay.
In the remaining 4 months, I need to have a job for at least 3 months. So technically, I only had a 1 month period to find a job. Otherwise, I had to move back to India by force. I had no other choice. So I was really tense. I was nervous and I was under tremendous pressure also. I didn't know what to do. How do I handle this? So I was talking to my uncle that the next day morning that it's a tough time. If I only have a month, if I don't get a job within a month, then I have to move back. And I don't know what I'm gonna do once I go back to India. I had a lot of dreams, you know. Every kid when they go to US, they have a dream of living an American life. But and I was actually, you know, the shattering of American dream was almost a 1 month away for me. So that was a tough time. And then, so next, when I was doing that talk only, I got a call from a company. I got a call from a company that, you know, we have received your resume. You have applied for an SAP consultant. We have received your resume last night. You have applied. And then I remember, you know, the previous night I was talking about, I have applied to that job. And he said, we would like to ask you, we would like to have you for the interview. I said, yeah, sure. And that was the first interview I had, and I said, when? And he said, can you come at 2 o'clock today, 2 in the afternoon? I said, yeah, absolutely. And I was very excited and I was very nervous also, because that was the first interview after 8 months, the first interview after I graduated. And so that was the, and so I immediately went, I went to haircut, because it was so sudden. I went to haircut, I did shave, and you know, become a good gentleman boy. First interview, period, you know, I'm going and all those. So at 2 o'clock, I entered into the office, and I was sitting right in front of the reception area, the waiting lounge, you know, where I used to sit. I said that I came, I was there, I remember I was there 10 minutes early. So around 2 o'clock was my interview. They said come at 2 o'clock. So I went there at around 1:50. I was there in their office. I gave my ID, my resume that I'm here. The HR guy came, he greeted me and he said, why don't you sit? I was sitting there. And after some time, I hear the voice from the back end. So it was a glass cabinet. So reception, and there was a glass, transparent glass door right behind the reception area.
Okay.
And so you could see everything, and if anybody speaks louder, you can hear a voice. And that time I heard that, so the guy who was supposed to take my interview, that guy who looked at my resume, and he was talking to HR that this guy is a fresher guy and I don't want a fresher right now. I want a 10 to 15 years of minimum experience people, because I have a project in hand. I need to place people on site for the project, and I don't have really time for the pressure. So I was not an eavesdrop, but I could hear that was the conversation.
So it was about, technical consultant?
It was purely a technical SAP consultant who goes to the client side and do the job, right? That was the job. And then I heard that by sitting outside, and that moment, I was again it's done. I'm not gonna get this job anyways. It's probably a waste of time. But that time I said, this is the only opportunity I have. I need to do something. But see, on a formality side, that guy did took my interview. So he called me inside. I went into his. So the manager was supposed to be taking my interview. I went to his office. I sat there, and he was a very fair. He was a great guy actually. So he's a good friend now, of course. But
so he was also an Indian.
He was also an Indian. Well, SAP has a lot of Indians in the entire SAP community is dominated by Indian community significantly. So yeah, that guy was also an Indian. His name was Mr. Sanjay Dere. So he immediately called me. He called me. I went into his office. He said that, "Rohan, listen, I'm sorry, but we are looking for the very experienced guy for this position. And apparently, you don't have an experience. So I'm sorry, but I might not be able to give you this position. So I want to apologize on my behalf that miscommunication happened and everything." So that time I actually didn't know. I was just listening. I was, because after 8-9 months, I got a first interview call. That was my first interview, and I was very excited in the morning. And then he said that this is not the right position for you, and I'm sorry, it was a miscommunication happened. So I have no clue. But then I asked myself only one question, that this is the only opportunity I have. Either it's do or die situation for me. Either I will do something about it, or I might not get another chance. So I simply said one thing, that, "Sir, can I ask you for a favor?" He said, "Yeah, sure, Rohan. What's up?" So I said, "Sir, this is my first interview. I graduated in 2007. This is my first interview, and I understand. Don't give me a job. I understand your situation. But can you ask me a few questions about SAP and my concept, so at least I get an experience of how interviews are and whatever questions I have to face in the future." So, because it's the first interview I have got after 8 months, I was very excited in the morning, but that's okay. But at least give me an experience so I could do much better in the next interview. And he said, "Sure, but I can only give you 5 minutes because I really don't have too much time to spare." I said, "No problem, sir. At least you can ask me a few questions, that these type of questions can come in the interview, and you should be preparing for those." So I said, so he agreed. He said, "Yeah, fine." And he asked me a question that, "Rohan, walk me through the entire sales cycle. You know, so in SAP, we call it order to cash, we call it procure to pay." So he said, "Okay, walk me through the entire sales cycle." So I said, "Can I use the blackboard?" I said, "Can I use a whiteboard?" I said, "Yeah, definitely." So I started, and I started drawing the process and, you know, explaining the process. And apparently he was interested, he was listening to me. He asked me a few questions. He asked me the postings, that how the financial posting happens, and all the technical questions he started asking me. And apparently that interview, 5 minutes, it actually lasted for almost 1 hour.
Oh, I see.
1 hour. And then after 1 hour, he said, "You know what, Rohan, I have looking for the for filling up this role since last almost 2-3 months now. I have interviewed more than 15-20 people, and I have also interviewed the people who has 10-15 years of experience in their resume, but they also couldn't ask the basic questions, the basic technical questions which you ask as a fresher. So you know what, I will make your first interview the last interview. Let's come on board. And I wanted to go out of this office with an offer letter, and that was just the moment, you know." And he called the HR guy and he said, "You know, give this guy an offer letter right away." And that's how I got my first job. I came out with that office with an offer letter in my hand. Of course, it was not a great salary or something, but it was a job. I had a job. And they agreed to apply for my H-1B, so that's how I started my job career in the US. And so September 1st was my joining. September 1st was, I guess, a Sunday. So September 2nd was a Monday, was my joining in 2008.
Okay, and that was the how you have started your first.
That's
job.
How I started
and
my first.
You have worked for 4 years for the same company.
I worked for 6 years for the same company.
Oh, super.
6-7 years for the same.
Okay.
So 2008 to 2013 December, so almost 5.5 years almost. 6 years.
So once, I mean, you were working in the USA, you was working in a very good company, SAP, right? Then what you made to come to back to India, and I mean, why you have moved to the India?
Well, I, as I said, I always wanted to start my so when I actually, you know, when I started a job, you know, I started understanding how the market is, how the business works, and then that time a lot of stories about these startups also. So that also inspired me a little, or somewhere that seed was being planted that yes, I wanted to do a startup. So then I decided that okay, no. So I started doing the research somewhere, if I want to say, somewhere in mid 2011, I started exploring the opportunities, that what opportunities I could potentially have if I want to do the startup. So I started looking for the challenges, that what challenges or what are the areas which can be addressed or which address as a startup, and what startup I can start. So I already started thinking about those things. And US is a very, to be honest with you, US is a very developed, US is a developed country, you know, and it's all good, you know, but as an immigrant, as an H-1B holder, it is very difficult. So it was a lot of, not those type of difficulties which cannot be addressed, but my primary focus was that, okay, you know, I should be focusing on the energy which is more productive. And being in India, developing countries, I find that there is a huge opportunity in India itself. So if you really want to grow as a startup, that India is the place to be. US, yes, of course, job wise, it's a perfectly fair place. I had a wonderful job over the period of 6-7 years when I resigned. I had a good salary. So I was living that American dream, which every, you know, I was talking about. So everything was good and fancy. But there was no satisfaction, you know. It was, at the end of the day, it was a job. And then I decided, if I really want to do something on my own, then I want to do it in India, because that's where the opportunity lies, because opportunity is huge there. See, if I want to give you an analogy, you know, let's say we are in an iPhone, US is like an iPhone 11, upgraded to the full level. In order to upgrade, you need to wait for the iPhone 12. It's like that. But on the same side, in India is somewhere in iPhone 7, 6, 7 or 8. Where. So you have an opportunity to upgrade. So this is how it is. So I find that there is a huge opportunity in India only if I want to start something. And what better place to start than your own country? Because it's your own. You can do it. So you don't have to go with the legal compliances and so many things. In US, there was too much immigration compliance. So
Rohan, you have said that, you know, you have thought about this startup or starting your own business or starting a startup, and that is that for what, I mean, you came to India, and you have said earlier that, you know, once you came to India, you have started job, right? So instead of startup, why you have started doing job with Zydus?
You got me there. So I'll tell you. So when I was US in 2011, one of the areas which I was thinking that I will start my startup is a field in healthcare sector. So I was planning. I came back within India. So there in US, I also started doing exploration. So my idea was very simple that time, that okay, you know, Indian healthcare is still have a lot of room for improvement. On the same side, US healthcare is very much very advanced. So I will study the US healthcare. I will actually see, being an NACP guy, I always have process guy. I always understand the processes of the business. So I said, okay, you know, let me understand the healthcare process in US, and if I can simply replicate and get to India. That was a very basic idea I came up with. Each other, you know, we will get the whatever there is in US, we will simply take that and put it in it, and we'll get it implemented in Indian healthcare industry, and that will give me a boost. So I started studying the US healthcare from 2011. So I studied almost 2 years. I went to the different US hospitals. I understand what the processes are. I started looking for the technology which is used in the healthcare sector, and how the automation happens, EMR, electronic medical record, because that is very basic in US, and India we don't use EMR. So I thought, you know, if I can bring those things in India, that could be a good model. So that was the very basic thought I had. And that's, so 2 years I did my study. So when I, 2013, when I came back, I had an idea of, uh, I had, uh, idea of having a full-fledged hospital management software for the Indian hospitals, which is very advanced and very technological driven, and more from a clinical perspective rather than purely a transactional perspective. So clinical side of the focus, I had a more focus. I also had a company that I established called the New Age Infotech, the New Age Technologies. And I also started interviewing people and everybody. But then when I came back to India with the mapping and company was also, so that time also, when as soon as I came, I did a startup called New Age Technologies. But then my implementation, no, I realized that Indian healthcare is very different. The copy pasting will not work here. So US, whatever the processes are, it has to be redesigned with the Indian processes, because Indian healthcare process is different. So that was first wrong assumption I made back there. So I realized that, no, I need to correct it. If I go with the same business model, I will fail. So now the time came that I really had to understand Indian healthcare business.
Yeah, the entire user experience.
So I was like, no, how do I do that? So then I decided, okay, you know what? So I went to see one of the doctor, and I asked them that this is what my idea is and this is what I really want to start, but I want to understand the Indian hospital or Indian healthcare system. So I want to volunteer in your hospital for a few months. And then he said, you know, that is very difficult, but I will put you into contact with one more doctor, and he apparently is a good friend of my dad. So I went to see him, and he said, you know, Rohan, volunteering might be a little bit difficult, but our hospital also has a challenge in the technical areas, and we are looking for a technical expertise because we are coming up with a bigger hospital in Ahmedabad. And the vision is to have the state-of-the-art technology in the hospital. So why don't you join us full time? That time I thought, okay, anyways, I was planning to volunteer for a few months without anything. If somebody is paying me some salary for that, why not to take it? I will resign it after 6 months once I get my knowledge. So I said, okay, fine. And that's based on that thought I joined Zydus Hospital. Because Zydus has that time only one hospital in Anand.
Okay.
And there also you need to work a lot of the technological challenges over there. So you have to upgrade everything and systemized everything, the entire system. And Ahmedabad hospital was coming up. It was that time, it was just under construction building. So then I decided, yeah, okay, fine, I'll work for a few months and see how it goes, and at least that helped me understand the Indian way of hospital working. But then you know, based on your nature, you know, it was started, the Indian hospital, the Ahmedabad hospital was getting started, and that time I realized, you know, not realized, but you know, based on the nature, you know, you can't get out in the middle of it. Then I decided that, you know, let me first commission this entire hospital. Once the entire hospital finishes, I will finish my project, this, then I'll take out. Rather than 6 months, I ended up spending 3 years with Zydus Group. I have Zydus Hospitals where I have implemented the entire IT infrastructure and everything. And then once it was set up, then again I had a transition. I was thinking to come back, but then that time I got an opportunity to work. In a pharma business, in the strategy. So the profile which I was offered was very fascinating. And I didn't know what I was thinking that time, but the profile was very fascinating. The everything was very good, and so I took a transfer in a pharma sector. I worked there for a year. Now the entire whole process, no, even in the hospital 3 years, even in the 1 year with the pharma sector, I was using the design thinking approach, because that approach was very natural to me.
Yes.
I was not consciously putting a design thinking. It was just a natural approach for me, and with the result I used to get, it was very different from the very conventional view of. And that time I also realized that how the Indian corporates work, and because I had to deal with a lot of other customers, a lot of different, came to different corporates. And that made me thinking that, you know, instead of going back to healthcare sector, because working in an hospital, I realized that there are too many players and there are too many competitions. I'm not doing anything really different. I'm just one more hospital management software supplier. I am not making any difference to the industry. So it's like, okay, you know, I don't want to be just another startup and start going to the same rut. And it's like, I want to really do something. And while working with this, as I said, I was using the design thinking approach. I realized that why don't I start a consulting for that design thinking itself? Because that's where the company really needs. That's where the company can really benefit. Because we are still working in a same old way of the corporate life, where there is a lot of inefficiencies. Lot of processes are just being carried away since years and years and years and years and years. And there's a huge opportunity to actually redesign that and make the processes more efficient. And that's where I decided that, you know, so I parked that newest technology, went into I started design thinking and innovation consulting in 2017.
What do you think? What are the kind of ecosystems India has for these startups? And if suppose there is some gap or there is something where, you know, that it needs improvement, then how design thinking can improve the startup ecosystem in India?
Sure. So India has actually, I'll tell you, India is doing very good in terms of startup ecosystem. We have lot of, if you know, recently, since last 2 years, government of India is also, central government is also promoting startup in a big way. We have Atal Innovation Schemes and Atal Innovation Centers. So, and we have, in this last budget also, startup has a good budget allocated. So in terms of ecosystem, we are improving, significantly improving. And the support is also improving. However, we have a very good and very efficient incubation centers, but those, all the incubation centers are currently are in big cities. Let's say, for example, you will find it in Ahmedabad. You go to Mumbai, Pune, Bangalore, Hyderabad, Delhi. You know, or everywhere you will find a very good incubation centers which supports the entire startup ecosystem. However, talent can come from anywhere. So there are a lot more talent is also resides outside these cities, and that's where the ecosystem is. I think there is huge room for improvement in that area for the small towns or you know, the talent to be brought from the towns and the small cities. So that's where the ecosystem still there are huge room for improvement. But we are working very. So I think the way the entire ecosystem is moving towards India, we will get there soon enough than later. So I think that's the very good idea. Now in terms of how design thinking is improving. So as I said, you know, we recently, since last 6 months, we have started working with the incubation centers. Because earlier our focus target customers was only the large corporates, that we used to only work with the large corporates as a design thinking consultants. But then now we have, since last month, we have started tying up with the incubation centers as well as the startup ecosystem. And because design thinking is simply the tool which helps you to, the concept which helps you to focus on the innovation. And startup. So I'll tell you, I get a good, I'll give you a very good example. I get a lot of young entrepreneurs or a lot of students, because I'm very closely also attached with an academics and colleges. So I get a lot of my students come to me and they said, you know, sir, I have got a very good idea. How do I, or I met a lot of students or a lot of young enthusiastic, you know, who has an entrepreneurial streak. They come to me and they said, we have a very good idea. But we don't know how to actually convert that idea into the executionable model. Now, execution is not the only challenge. Scalability also needs to be considered.
Absolutely.
Right. So that is where I always say that don't come up with a good idea, because good idea might not lead you to a successful startup. Come up with a good problem to solve. Because the moment you find a problem to solve, you can convert that, the solution to that problem
can convert into the good idea. Because idea could be good, maybe good for you, but how do you make people buy your idea? But if you have done your research enough, if you put an effort to identify the problem which people are facing, and if you can come and say that, Rohan, I have a very good problem, or I have identified this problem and I think this problem needs to be addressed, then that can convert into the good scalable business model. So that is one thing that has, so in the design thinking approach, we only work with the incubation centers, we conduct the design thinking workshops, we give them the tools to help them how to identify, how to craft the problem, how to solve that problem then, how to come up with an idea, how to do ideations, how to actually define the problem from the very beginning, then how to do ideation and how to go early in the market, early go to market. Because if you take too much time, if you spend too much money, if you spend too much time and then idea fails, failure is inevitable. Failure is every startup has to go through the failure cycle. It is how you accept it and how fast you actually take the failure, how fast you reiterate and move towards the successful ideation. So that is the entire defining an MVP, which is minimum viable product, defining the prototype, go to a small scale pilot, go to market and test and validate your idea in the business place. Not validation within the team, with actually validation with the market. And that's where we actually help startups as well as these all the startups.
Yes, Rohan. So you are also participating in so many forums where or the events where startups are addressed, or there are so many kind of public speaking events where you are participating and you are talking about the innovation and the design thinking, and you are also mentoring some of the startups who are actually at the early stage. So what do you think, I mean, in terms of mentoring or the startup mentorship, how is it useful for the startup, and does it really give their direction, and what is the importance of it? Yeah.
Yes, of course, because when I talk with startups, we can come up with a lot of experience, and so as I said, when we work with the startups, we can actually help them to get into the right, they are always in the right direction. I don't say they have a very good ideas and everything, but getting into the market early stage, defining the right MVP is very important. So prioritizing that, for example, if I have a startup which is more of a technology driven startup and their technology, let's take an example of I have one startup which is developing a mobile app for one concept. Right, it's a mobility startup. Now, what are the features to be defined at the very first place? If you try to put it in the initial ideation stage, they have identified n number of features that they wanted. Is it really feasible to put all the n number of features at the very 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 beginning? No, that's not that. Right. Because you never know first. How do you narrow it down? How do you identify the core features first, just to validate the idea? Who are my target customers? How do I reach them? Right? They might be technically good, but going into the go-to-market in a rapid pace, addressing the right target audience, that support is very important. And that is where we help make them that yes, they do indeed do some innovations. Like, for example, I'll tell you, there are so many startups, they have come up with an idea, but they are just one more idea into the same ecosystem. How do you differentiate yourself? How do you make, how do you stand out? It's like, for example, giving you an example, I said, I wanted to start a healthcare software. If that time I asked myself the same question, that if I'm going to create an HMIS, there are more than 50 HMIS softwares only in India. Small scale, big scale, more than 50. I ask myself a very simple question: how my HMIS is going to be different from the other startup? And I didn't have answer. And then my chances of failure is much higher, because I don't differentiate myself. So that is where the mentorship is very important. And the rapid pace into market. Otherwise, they will do it. They are smart. These are the young entrepreneurs who the college graduates who are directly getting into the startup field. They have the passion, and that is what they have. They have an entrepreneurial streak. That is what they are. So they are all smart guys, and they technically, as I said, if there is no mentorship given, no, they will figure out their way. But they might take a little longer. It is, and as I said, in this volatile, we have to focus on the how rapidly we can go in the market and how fast we can address it and how fast we can scale. That is the only where I think the mentorship is very important.
Okay, and Rohan, what message do you want to convey to the young startups and the fellow business members or the people, those who are starting the first time business?
Well, if I want to really pass on the message, I'll pass one message that don't worry about the failure. Failure is the part of it. You will fail. I don't deny that. And cherish the failure. Learn from your failure. Just don't give up. Just don't give up. Because I have seen so many people, so many startups, they try, put an effort to 1 year, 1 year, 2 years, and then they said, no, it's not working out. And they simply give up. So don't ever give up. That is, if I want to give you that one, the game, I always say the rule of the game is simply one in the startup field. Just don't give up. That's all.
Perfect. And so, Rohan, you are a very, very well-known design thinking consultant in India, right? And so, I understand that you are also associated or participating in so many things, that you are already associated with so many organizations. So how do you manage your work-life balance?
I have a very different answer which you may not like, but I think that work-life balance concept is a ridiculous concept. And the way I say it, because if you really want to succeed, you really have to put a hard work in the work. So you have to compromise your life at some point of time. Give me one. Think about anything. You know, we always cherish the story of all these successful people. You will always see that these guys was working. Oh, he was successful, but in early days he used to work for 20 hours, 24 hours. He used to sleep at his office, and these kind of all stories we have seen it. So that's the now. Do they have the work-life balance? No, he was working 24/7, rigorously. So my work-life balance is, I have told my family that I'm into early stage. Also, and I'm working, so please pardon me for a few years, I might not be available, but I really need to focus on that, and they do really understand. So my work-life balances, they understand, my family understands the effort we put in, and so I said, you know, work-life balances, if you really want to be successful, if you really want to achieve the great heights, then you have to compromise on a lot of things and focus only on work, hard work. And there is no alternate of hard work.
Absolutely, very true. And Rohan, I mean, so apart from these all questions, is there anything which you want to share, you know, in addition to this, about the design thinking or about the Indian startup ecosystem or anything?
So as I said, in the Indian startup ecosystem, I have already said quite. If there any particularly, you can of course always ask me. Design thinking, for the design thinking, as I said, it's a huge opportunity out there, and there are very few people who are actually in this field. So I think design thinking is very important for anybody. So even if not me, even if you are a startup, or if anybody who is thinking of the startup, I think they should look at the way the design thinking is the approach is being crafted, how and apply even the large corporates. Small and medium segments are also a good area which I have not explored yet, because I'm too much tied up with the large corporates and the startup ecosystem. So those are the two areas I'm targeting, but I think every field, every one of us needs the design thinking in their field, because disruption is right at your doorstep. So I always say that if you don't do it now, you will never be able to do it again. And if you don't disrupt in your field, you will be disrupted soon enough. So start being a part of a
design. The small business or the micro business can also go for the design thinking implementation.
Absolutely, every possible, whether it's a industry, whether it's a retail business, whether it's a homegrown business, whether it's a small, medium, any sector, any field, you can apply this concept. It is simply a concept of problem solving and innovation. And now, can anybody tell me that no, their particular business do not have room for innovation? No, that's not possible. Every small business has room for innovation, has room for improvement, has a problems and has a challenges. So then there you go, design thinking is there. It is only the awareness is more important in this.
Alright, so we have learned a lot of things about, you know, how design thinking works for the small, medium enterprises and the large corporates. Rohan, thank you so much for coming and giving your valuable time.
Sure, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Praveen, for having me, and thank you, team Vyapaar Jagat, for putting so much effort to hosting me. So thank you very much.